श्री परमात्मने नमः। वाई इज अ ब्राह्मिन एन आइडियल मैन फॉर हिंदूज। इन द सीरीज ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंदाज प्रैक्टिकल वेदांता, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लुक इनटू दिस क्वेश्चन एज टू व्हाई द ब्राह्मिन्स फॉर टाइम इमेमोरियल हैव बीन ऑन द टॉप ऑफ द कास्ट हायरार्की ऑफ सनातन धर्मा इन वैदिक कल्चर। व्हाट आर द स्पिरिचुअल फिलोसॉफिकल रीजंस फॉर दैट? Why is a Brahmin an ideal Hindu? Swami Vivekananda, in his Kumbakonam lecture in South India, titled The Mission of the Vedanta, answers this question brilliantly. But before I go into that, let me in brief explain to you the simple meaning as to what is the meaning of the term Brahmin. Brahmin means the seeker of the truth, the seeker of Brahman, the seeker of the Atman, the one who is ever in pursuit of the Brahman, the supreme reality, is a Brahmin. The one who is in exclusive pursuit of, full time, manasa vacha karmana, with body, mind and spirit, a Brahman is supposed to chase and run after nothing but supreme truth, that is Brahman. That is why he is called Brahmin. There is a very popular term all over India for the Brahmins, and most of them are addressed as Pandit. Pandit ji. How are you, Pandit ji? What is the meaning of the term Pandit? That has been very brilliantly defined and explained by no other than Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. That I put in brief and then I'll come back to Swami Vivekananda's answer to this question. Panda Shabda is, let's understand what is Pandit. Pandit comes from the root Sanskrit word Panda. Panda means Gyan, Pragya, consciousness. The supreme reality, the supreme truth is known as Panda. And the knower of that truth, the knower of that reality, in simple terms, the knower of the Brahman, the Paramatman, alone is called Pandit. In Vedas, in the Vedanta philosophy. And what Lord Krishna says about a Pandit. Who is a Pandit? What is the qualification of a Pandit? First, let me recite that. Most radical and revolutionary definition of Pandit in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavan Krishna says, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne ब्राह्मणे गविहस्तिनि शुनि चैव स्वपाके च पंडिता समदर्शिना। हु इज अ पंडित? द पंडित इज द वन हु लुक्स अपॉन एंड सीज विथ वन आई, दैट इज with equal view, with a sense of equanimity, upon the most learned enlightened Brahmin, an elephant, a cow, a dog, and a dog eater called Chandala, the lowest of the lowest of the lowly Shudras. He was to be dog eaters, Chandalas. So a Pandit, a knower of truth, doesn't distinguish between a most humble, learned Brahmin, an elephant, a cow, a dog, and a dog eater. He looks upon all of them with the same eye. What is the philosophical meaning of that? It means the Pandit is one who has realized the truth that Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma Tattvam Asi Ayamatma Brahma Pragyanam Brahma Aham Brahmasmi. Only the one who knows the truth that one self, one Brahman is the self of all, one supreme reality, the Satchidananda. Satchidananda alone, the existence absolute, consciousness pure, and bliss infinite, alone is appearing as myriads of beings, objects, the essence of all the differently looking objects or beings with different names, forms, and attributes. The source, substance, and substratum of all of them is one and the same reality. That is called Brahman, that is called Atman. Therefore, a Pandit is one who sees in everyone without exception, without distinction, without any social, cultural value addition to any one of them, the one supreme reality, that is Brahman, which is pervading all of them. The lowest to the highest are nothing but rays of Brahman, manifestations of Brahman, particles of Brahman, and in reality, everything is Brahman alone. The one who, not by just listening or studying the Vedas or Vedanta philosophy, but who has imbibed, who has realized, and the only one who is enlightened, who has through personal, intimate, immediate, intuitive, inspired experience has realized that supreme truth, that there is underlying unity between the entire diversity of the phenomenal universe, and that cause of, that source of, that basis and background of the unity is Brahman, one reality, the Self, the Supreme Self, the Paramatman, the Maheshwara. Therefore, he sees, a Pandit sees in everyone and everything only the Supreme Reality, the Brahman. And that is why that Pandit or Brahmin means the one who has reached the pinnacle of a human destiny, a human objective. And that is why the Pandits or Brahmins were at the top of this social pyramid or social hierarchy, because that is the objective of every human being. When I present before you the views of Swami Vivekananda, you would know why everybody on this planet, every human being cutting across time and climb, should aspire to become a Brahmin. Brahmin is not a caste. Brahmin is the highest and the supreme glory and manifestation and potential being manifested in a human being. Just being born in a particular caste to a certain parents doesn't entitle you philosophically and spiritually to be called a Brahmin. But that essentially began, essentially, that all of them belonged to that particular caste or clan or race. They were supposed to be exclusively devoted, every word, thought and action, 20 hours. They are in search of the Brahman, the Paramatman. That is why they are known as Brahmins. And they were the crowning glory. The Brahmins and the Brahminhood was and is still and will ever remain from time immemorial in its true sense. Brahmin in the sense that the one who has realized the supreme truth, even the one who is seeking the supreme truth with exclusive devotion to that pursuit, he is a Brahmin and he is a Pandit, and therefore in every religion, in fact, in some or the other way, one aspires to become a Brahmin, one aspires to become a Pandit. Means the one who is going to realize the transcendent reality within the immanent, the reality beyond the sensory perception, the momentary, ephemeral reality of the matter and physical world is not the only reality. So they were the investigators, researchers and scientists. Most of the Upanishadic wisdom has been given by the Brahmins, the rishis. The rishi is ultimate ideal, the ultimate crowning glory of Vedanta and Vedic culture. The wisdom, the nectarian wisdom of the supreme reality poured down from the lips of those Brahmins, the knowers of the truth. Therefore, unless and until you know the philosophical and spiritual background of that, mere blasting from every platform, and especially after the independence movement, after 1947 with the dawn of the new constitution, the Brahmins have assumed a very different political social connotation. But let us see, 123 years ago, what Swami Vivekananda says on this word Brahmin and the caste Brahmin, and why the Brahminhood should be the utmost ideal of everybody in the universe, not only Sanatana Dharma. Swami Vivekananda gives very profound reasons for that. This is part of study I had presented, the Kumbakonam lecture titled The Mission of the Vedanta. So second part of that lecture, titled The Mission of the Vedanta, has this issue dwelt on. Swami Vivekananda says about Brahmin, "I must frankly tell you that I am neither a caste breaker nor a mere social reformer." And let me tell you, those of you who don't know, Swami Vivekananda was not born as a Brahmin. He was born as a Kayasth. "I must frankly tell you that I am neither a caste breaker nor a mere social reformer. I have nothing to do directly with your castes or with your social reformation. Live in any caste you like, but that is no reason why you should hate another man or another caste. It is love and love alone that I preach, and I base my teaching on the great Vedantic truth of the sameness and omnipresence of the soul of the universe, one self, one soul, that is the omnipresence. Present reality of the entire universe, that is foundation of the entire Vedantic teaching. For nearly the past 100 years our country has been flooded with social reformers and various social reform proposals. Personally, I have no fault to find with these reformers. Most of them are good, well-meaning men, and their aims too are very laudable on certain points. But it is quite a patent fact that this 100 years of social reform has produced no permanent and valuable result appreciable throughout the country. Platform speeches have been made by the thousands, denunciations in volumes after volumes have been hurled upon the devoted head of the Hindu race and its civilization, and yet no good practical result has been achieved. And where is the reason for that? The reason is not hard to find. It is in the denunciation itself. As I told you before, in the first place, we must try to keep our historically acquired character as a people, the Hindus as a race. I grant that we have to take a great many things from other nations, that we have to learn many lessons from outside. But I am sorry to say that most of our modern reform movements have been inconsiderate imitations of Western means and methods of work. Listen this line very carefully again. I am sorry to say that most of our modern reform movements have been inconsiderate imitations of Western means and methods of work, and that surely will not do good for India. Therefore, it is that all our recent reform movements have had no results. They were imported, they were mere imitations of the West, and even today, most of the very radical ideas are just imported, photocopy, cut-paste ideas, no organic understanding of them in our context. In the second place, denunciation is not at all the way to do good. That there are evils in our society, even a child can see. And in what society are there no evils? And let me take this opportunity, my countrymen, of telling you that in comparing the different races and nations of the world, I have come to the conclusion that our people are, on the whole, the most moral and most godly. And our institutions are, in their plan and purpose, best suited to make mankind happy. Here, the institutions, Swamiji is referring in terms of cultural, social institutions of ours. Religious, cultural, social institutions, which have come from time immemorial, they have stood the test of the time. I don't therefore want any reformation. My ideal is growth, expansion, development on national lines. As I look back upon the history of my country, I don't find in the whole world another country which has done quite so much for the improvement of the human mind. Therefore, I have no words of condemnation for my nation. I tell them, you have done well, only try to do better. Unquote. Great things have been done in the past in this land, and there is both time and room for greater things to be done yet. I am sure you know that we cannot stand still. If we stand still, we lie. We have either to go forward or to go backward. We have either to progress or to degenerate. Our ancestors did great things in the past, but we have to grow into a fuller life and march beyond even their great achievements. How can we now go back and degenerate ourselves? That cannot be. That must not be. Going back will lead to national decay and death. Therefore, let us go forward and do yet greater things. That is what I have to tell you all. I am no preacher of any momentary social reform. I am not trying to remedy evils. I only ask you to go forward and to complete the practical realization of the scheme of human progress that has been laid out in the most perfect order by our ancestors. I only ask you to work to realize more and more the Vedantic ideal of the solidarity of man and his inborn divine nature. I'll repeat this line, listen it very carefully. I only ask you to work to realize more and more the Vedantic ideal of the solidarity of man and his inborn divine nature. This is the heart and soul of Vedantic religion or Vedantic philosophy, and this is heart and soul of entire Sanatana Dharma, Hinduism. This is foundation upon which all our social, cultural, religious institutions are based and have evolved from and around. Had I the time, I would gladly show you how everything we have now to do was laid out years ago by our ancient lawgivers and how they actually anticipated all the different changes that have taken place and are still to take place in our national institutions. They also were breakers of caste, but they were not like our modern men. They did not mean by the breaking of caste that all the people in a city should sit down together to a dinner of beefsteak and champagne, nor that all fools and lunatics in the country should marry when, where, and whom they choose and reduce the country to a lunatic asylum. Nor did they believe that the prosperity of a nation is to be gauged by the number of husbands its widows get. I have yet to see such a prosperous nation. The ideal man of our ancestors was the Brahmin. Now here is the answer of the question I put in the beginning. Who is a Brahmin and why Brahmins are the ideal Hindus and ideal of every Hindu? The ideal man of our ancestors was the Brahmin. In all our books stands out prominently this ideal of the Brahmin. In Europe there is my lord, the cardinal, who is struggling hard and spending thousands of pounds to prove the nobility of his ancestors. And he will not be satisfied until he has traced his ancestry to some dreadful tyrant who lived on a hill and watched the people passing by, and whenever he had the opportunity, he sprang out on them and robbed them. That was the business of this nobility bestowing ancestors. And my Lord Cardinal is not satisfied until he can trace his ancestry to one of these. But in India, on the other hand, the greatest princes seek to trace their descent to some ancient sage who dressed in a bit of loincloth, lived in a forest, eating roots and studying the Vedas. It is there that the Indian prince goes to trace his ancestry. You are of the high caste when you can trace your ancestry to a rishi and not otherwise. Rishis are the pinnacle of human manifestation, the divinity manifested in the rishis makes them the height of human potential, the peak fulfillment of human potential, the supreme realization of the human potential. And in India, all of us seek our ancestry, the gotra. What is this gotra? Particular rishi is traced back to particular rishi, Gautama, Kaushika, Kashyapa, Vasishtha. That is the difference between the West and the East. None of them were kings. Our rishis were not the kings and queens and emperors. They were barely clad with loin clothes, living in caves, surviving on begging alms, but studying the Vedas and doing investigation and sadhana to realize the Supreme Brahman, the Supreme Reality, the ultimate mystery of the universe. They are our ideals. We are children of those rishis in India. And we feel proud to trace our history. The princes, the kings and queens of this country don't feel proud to trace their ancestry to a king or queen, but to a rishi, a sage, a seer, a saint. That is difference between the fundamental difference between the Western paradigm and the Indian national paradigm as to how to look upon entire social, cultural, political fabric of Indian national life. Our ideal of high birth, therefore, is different from that of others. Others here is the Western countries Swamiji is referring to. Our ideal is the Brahmin of spiritual culture. Our India's ideal. Our ideal is the Brahmin of spiritual culture and renunciation. Brahmin means the practitioner of spirituality, renunciation, humility, goodness, sattvika. Simple. By the Brahmin ideal, what do I mean? By the Brahmin ideal, what do I mean? Listen here carefully. I mean the ideal Brahminness in which worldliness is altogether absent and true wisdom is abundantly present. That is the ideal of the Hindu race. Have you not heard how it is declared that he, the Brahmin, is not amenable to law? You read the Manusmriti and then there you find it, that no law applies to Brahmins. Why? Swamiji is explaining as to why it was there and why it was so. Have you not heard how it is declared that he, the Brahmin, is not amenable to law, that he has no law, that he is not governed by kings, and that his body cannot be hurt? That is perfectly true. Don't understand it in the light thrown upon it by interested and ignorant fools. You find these days, in post-independent period, large number of this kind of fools and stupids as politicians and social reformers in our country. And that was, see, the foresight of Swami Vivekananda. Long ago, he could see that even that at that point of time, the tribe of these stupid fool vested interests trying to attack Hinduism and the Hindu race and Hindu culture in these superficial, flimsy grounds. Do not understand it in the light thrown upon it by interested and ignorant fools, but understand it in the light of the true and original Vedantic conception. If the Brahmin is he who has killed all selfishness and who lives and works to acquire and propagate wisdom and the power of love, if a country is altogether inhabited by such Brahmins, by men and women who are spiritual and moral and good, is it strange to think of that country as being above and beyond all law? What police, what military are necessary to govern them? Why should any one govern them at all? Why should they live under a government? They are good and noble, and they are the men of God. These are our ideal Brahmins, and we read that in the Satya Yuga there was only one caste, and that was the Brahmin. In Satya Yuga there was only caste, everyone was of the only one caste, that is Brahmins. Brahmins alone existed then. Later, with the fall of their spiritual growth and degeneration in social fabric, the rest of the castes are side effects of degeneration from Satya Yuga to Treta to Dwapar to now Kali Yuga. So in the Satya Yuga there was only one caste, and that was the Brahmin. We read in the Mahabharata that the whole world was in the beginning peopled with Brahmins, and that as they began to degenerate, they became divided into different castes, and that when the cycle turns round, they will go back to that Brahminical origin again. The entire human race will again return back to Brahminhood alone, because that alone is the supreme destination, the ultimate pinnacle that you are aspiring for, consciously or unconsciously. This cycle is turning round now, and I draw your attention to this fact. Therefore, our solution of the caste question is not degrading those who are already high up, is not running amok through food and drink, is not jumping out of our own limits in order to have more enjoyment, but it comes by every one of us fulfilling the diktats of our Vedantic religion, by our attaining spirituality, and by our becoming the ideal Brahmin. The ideal Brahmin is the one who is exclusively Manasa Vacha Karmana, in word, thought and action, devoted in the pursuit of Brahman, in the pursuit of search of truth, self-realization, God-realization, is the sole objective of a Brahmin, the supreme ideal of a Brahmin, and those who are pursuing that, they are the true Brahmins. And anyone in any country, any culture, who is pursuing this pursuit, the pursuit of, in one word, whosoever is aspiring for self-realization, is a Brahmin. And they must be respected, and they are to a large extent respected in every time and clime. And that would be a great boon for the mankind. There is a law laid on each one of you in this land by your ancestors, whether you are Aryans or non-Aryans, Rishis or Brahmins or the very lowest outcasts. The command is the same to you all, that you must make progress without stopping, and that from the highest man to the lowest pariah, everyone in this country has to try and become the ideal Brahmin. You have to aspire to become an ideal Brahmin, the seeker of truth, knower of the truth, preacher of the truth, practitioner of truth. That is the highest achievement, not only of an individual, but a society, a country, a culture, an era, where the largest number of, you see, let me put it in a simple scientific formula. The greatness of an era and the greatness of any culture or country is directly proportionate to the degree of people seeking truth. Truth transcendence, put ordinarily, the degree and number of people seeking self-realization. The Vedantic idea is applicable not only here in India, but over the whole world. The entire human race ought to aspire for that Brahminhood. The Brahminhood means the search for and the quest for eternal truth, the search for Brahman, the Paramatman, the truth within and truth without. And anyone who is in search of truth is a Brahmin. And they are the most noble, most respectable and most valuable assets of any society. Raman Maharshi used to say a very profound line. It helped me in me deciding for sannyasa. Finally it clinched. I was under the illusion that what I am going to do, how I am going to serve my society, my country, once I become a sannyasi. Raman Maharshi says a very profound line, that a self-realization is the greatest contribution a human being can make unto the planet, unto the mankind, unto the society. Repeats, self-realization is the greatest contribution a human being can make to the society at large, because self-realization is not a mechanical state or an acquirement or achievement of an individual. A single self-realized human being throws out and radiates so much of light of love, knowledge and positivity and creativity and compassion, that the entire human race is uplifted, the entire era is uplifted in every respect, in social, political, cultural, in every field of your life, you get uplifted by the power, the spiritual power of the self-realized master, And that self-realized master alone is Brahmin. The more the number of Brahmins on the planet, the better it is. You won't find the biodiversity disappearing, the water bodies and river systems disappearing, wildlife becoming extinct, water becoming toxic, polluted. Why? Because we have become so narcissistic, self-obsessed, consumerist, materialist, consumption pattern unleashed in the, by the Western paradigms. Because we fundamentally believe that there is nothing beyond this world of sensory perception. Therefore, ultimate luxury, the ultimate objective of mine and everyone on this planet should be maximization of personal profit and thereby maximization of sensual pleasure. That is at the root of all the environmental catastrophe, ecological disaster, social harmony, terrorism, poverty, deprivation, war, you see. Large millions and millions of orphans being rendered destitute, joblessness, and now we have this corona pandemic. So self-realization, the search of the truth, has very profound direct impact on the entire society, not only for the so-called spiritual people or only the renunciates. No, this truth, this realization of the supreme truth is such a powerful phenomenon and event that a few of the self-realized souls radiate so much of energy. Even today, the way and whatever good and positivity, still there is a sense of camaraderie, compassion, love. It is because of at least some people knowing and living in that supreme reality, the reality of the Brahman, the reality of the Atman, the divine within radiating in my words, thoughts and actions, and that alone creates a sense of creativity, compassion and love among the nations, among the societies, among the families and in the individual life too. That is profound meaning of Brahminhood. That is the spiritual, philosophical and scientific implication of becoming a Brahmin. It's not a word. Brahmin is not a word you see on television channels, the self-appointed guardians of social reform today, bashing every day the Brahmins and the Brahminical system. The Brahminical system, the word Brahminical is being used as abuse in our country, that this person has a Brahminical mindset. What a curse! Brahminical mindset is the most noble and supremely blissful mindset. The mindset where, in true sense, a Brahminical mindset should radiate with love, compassion, empathy, sympathy, not as they present exploitative, narcissistic, self-centered, selfish. I am not saying that every Brahmin of today's India bears testimony to this high ideal. There would be many more who are worse than even the Shudras, the Pariahs. But what Swami Vivekananda is talking and what I am also talking about is, and what Vedanta and Vedic culture tells you, that the Brahmin is one who lives by the greatest ideals of the Vedanta, and that is Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma. Everything and everyone is manifestation of Brahman, that divine soul, and there is only one reality. I am Brahman, you are Brahman, I am you, you are I. Therefore, I have nothing to exploit. Why and how can I exploit myself? If I see myself in you, how can I hate you? How can I compete with you? How can I feel jealous? How can I harm you? A single self-realized master or a Brahmin is most powerful asset to the society. Any society, just don't go by words. Words have no meaning. Brahmin word and just somebody being born in a Brahmin family has no meaning unless and until that person is carrying that true character, bearing that torchlight for Dvaita Vedanta, where the divinity manifestation must be the ultimate objective. The one who is not radiating with lights, the one who is not radiating with the light of love, blissfulness, empathy, sympathy, compassion, and living for the others. Brahmins used to live for the entire society. They were the custodians. Even the kings and princes have to take their final orders from the Brahmins. But in many places, the Brahminism became, in certain sense, due to vested interests, tyrannical also. That is also part of the history. So we have to look upon this Brahminism or Brahmins in the right positive context so that we can resurrect, reassert, and revive that eternal meaning, Vedantic spiritual meaning of word Brahmin. And every one of us and every human being on the planet must aspire to become a Brahmin by word, thought, and action, by character, not by just declarations and speeches. Your character should be that of a Brahmin, living for truth and living by the truth, living for others, because there is no other, there is Brahman alone, the Supreme Lord alone is manifesting, and I have realized my own divinity, and I see the same divinity manifesting in you. Therefore, I worship everyone, I help everyone. I am every morning praying for welfare of everyone. Sarve, have you seen in any country, any culture, any creed, any religion, this kind of prayer? This Sachidanand from a small child grew up with this prayer. Every morning, at least one thing one has done. And this was the prayer. It has shaped the character within. Sarve nah sukhino bhavantu, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kasyat dukha bhag bhave. Every Brahman, every Indian was supposed to pray, not just by words, by his, her actions too, by deeds too, by character too, live for the welfare of the others. Not in the morning, every morning 2 minutes you chant this mantra and the rest of the day you put your entire energy to exploit others, to harm others, and to live a narcissistic life. No. This was running in the blood of the veins. It was in our breath. That is why this country produced Vedanta. This became a culture of the rishis. We are the heirs of the rishis, the self-realized masters, the Brahmans who declared unto themselves, Aham Brahmasmi Shivoham Brahmaivahamasmi. That glory can be attained by whosoever. He is a Brahmin and she is a Brahmin, anywhere in the world, whatever country, whatever culture, whatever faith she or she belongs to, I am ready to decorate that person. He is a Brahmin or she is a Brahmin. And in this country also, whosoever is able to manifest, Valmiki was a Shudra, Ved Vyas too was a Shudra, and he became greatest Rishi. Valmiki composed Ramayana, Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana also, the greatest of the rishis, the guru of Lord Rama. So many of the people, by their character, by their attainments, they are bestowed upon their status. Therefore, a Brahmin is the one who is ever seeking for the Brahman, the Supreme Reality. His entire life, his or her entire life is a continuous effort and endeavor for self-realization, God-realization, realization of the truth. Every moment is an investigation into that reality within, reality without. That Brahminhood has to be asserted, preached, promoted, and propagated even today in its right sense, in its Vedantic and spiritual context. This Vedantic idea is applicable not only here but over the whole world. Such is our ideal of caste as meant for raising all humanity slowly and gently towards the realization of that great ideal of the spiritual mind, who is non-resisting, calm, steady, worshipful, pure and meditative. In that ideal there is God. In the ideal of Brahmin, there is the ideal of God. In the ideal of Brahmin, there is the ideal of truth. In the ideal of Brahmin, there is search for truth. That is why the Brahmin is the ideal of the Hindu race. Because search of truth is the heart and soul of the entire Hindu race. The Vedic culture evolved around this single most quest, the search for the supreme reality, and that has stood the test of the time. Therefore, the Brahmins are symbol of that pinnacle, that the Vedic culture, the Sanatana Dharma and Vedanta philosophy, the crowning glory of Vedas, has brought to us. And still holds the potential to bring to whosoever pursues that. And the Shanti mantra I chanted, where in which country, which religion, which faith you think for, you work for, you meditate for the welfare of all. That is Brahminhood. That is Brahminhood. Not just being born by the womb of a Brahmin lady. Sachidanand dare say, you must acquire that character. The Brahmins too are at fault. They have degenerated. You are born in a Brahmin family, or you are behaving like a chandala. You are living a life of tamasic or a rajasic person. You are degenerated. You are drinking liquor. You are over obsessed with sensual pleasure and sensual pleasure alone. You are cunning, you are deceitful, you are cheating, you are harmful. You are not a Brahmin. Therefore, you must understand the meaning of the term Brahmin. Who is a Brahmin? And if you have to acquire the Brahminhood by your character, by your deeds, not by just words and speeches. How are these things to be brought about? I must again draw your attention to the fact that cursing and vilifying and abusing do not and cannot produce anything good. Entire Vedanta is a positive and creating philosophy. Creative philosophy doesn't believe in condemning anything. My Gurudev told me that was the biggest lesson, that don't be criticize anything, no one. This entire universe is full of taints because it's, he said, dosh purna. It's full of defects. That's why it's a phenomenal universe. You have to behave in a positive, creative, optimistic way. That is the fundamental principle of Vedanta that Swami Vivekananda is now laying emphasis on. I must again draw your attention to the fact that cursing and vilifying and abusing don't and cannot produce anything good. They have been tried for years and years and no valuable result has been obtained. Good results can be produced only through love, through sympathy. It is a great subject and it requires several lectures to elucidate all the plans that I have in view and all the ideas that are in this connection coming to my mind day after day. I must therefore conclude only reminding you of this fact that this ship of our nation, O Hindus, has been usefully plying here for ages. Today, perhaps it has sprung a leak. Today, perhaps it has become a little worn out. And if such is the case, it behoves you and me to try our best to stop the leak and holes in our national ship, our motherland. Let us tell our countrymen of the danger. Let them awake and help us. I will cry at the top of my voice from one part of this country to other to awaken the people to the situation and their duty. Suppose they don't hear me, still I shall not have one word of abuse for them, not one word of cursing. Great has been our nation's work in the past, and if we cannot do greater things in the future, let us have this consolation that we can sink and die together in peace. Be patriots, love the race which has done such great things for us in the past. Ah, the more I compare notes, the more I love you, my fellow countrymen. You are good and pure and gentle. You have been always tyrannized over, and such is the irony of this material world of Maya. Never mind that. The spirit will triumph in the long run. In the meanwhile, let us walk and let us not abuse our country. Let us not curse and abuse the weather-beaten and worn-out institutions of our thrice holy motherland. Swamiji is referring to the cultural, social, religious institutions that the onslaught of the Western values unleashed the criticism, condemnation, whole and soul, stock and barrel, condemnation of anything and everything Hindu. Today you see every morning on the television channels till evening, certain political parties, certain section of intelligentsia, especially the leftists, the self-appointed secularists, they keep lambasting, attacking everything, anything and everything, every symbol, every landmark of Hinduism. We can't, we must not allow this, no more. Thus far, okay, but no more anyone is going to be allowed to vilify, attack, assault our institutions, whether cultural, social. We are competent enough to correct the wrong things, and we have done so. But anything and everything that is Hindu, they just, certain political parties and political interests in this country have nothing, the single point agenda that is attacking Hindu, Hindu culture, Hindu traditions, Hindu wisdom, Hindu philosophy. That was what Swami Vivekananda foresaw. Long ago, 123 years ago, he saw. And even after independence, why Hindus are tolerating this nonsense? Two sadhus have been killed in broad daylight. And most of the political parties, nonsense, self-appointed guardians of the secularism are silent and mum. They are celebrating. I'm telling you, I know. Before sannyas, I was part and parcel of that dirty log of the dirty world. Every time any Hindu symbol is attacked, there is a section in this country who celebrates. You must reply in rightful way. They cannot be and they must not be allowed to vilify, to attack, to destroy our symbols, our institutions in the way they have been doing. No, this country is not going to allow it. Ahimsa Parmo Dharma, that is half of the truth. Dharma Hinsa Tadaiva Cha, this must be preached in every school to everyone. We are not helpless and helpless once to take all beating, nonsensical by the demonical people and demonical values. We have to fight back to defend ourselves. Aggression is not our value. We don't believe in violence. We believe in a non-violent life, livelihood and lifestyle. But you want to destroy me. I have every right to defend. The right of defense is available to every human being on the planet from time immemorial. Tell me which country, which caste, which value system doesn't apply that, and it must not be. The Mahabharata, the first world war of the world, happened for this only. What is rightful to you must belong to you. If you go beyond a limit, I will have to retaliate. I have to defend myself. I have every right to defend myself, my country, my culture, my values, my religion, my philosophy, my way of life. I am prepared to, and Hindus are open-hearted, open-minded. They always have learned whatever is good anywhere else. But you want to uproot me? You want to destroy me? This demonical design cannot be allowed anymore. The Swamiji, even at that point of Swami, Swami Vivekanand, faced a lot of this kind of nonsense. He saw it for the first hand when he was in the West and within our country. It is against this background Swami Vivekanand is talking about preserving our social, cultural institutions. Social, cultural, religious institutions, because without those institutions, what is Hinduism will remain just a name. You have been always tyrannized over, and such is the irony of this material world of Maya. Never mind that. The spirit will triumph in the long run. In the meanwhile, let us work and let us not abuse our country. Let us no curse. Let us not curse and abuse the weather beaten and worn. Let us not curse and abuse the weather beaten and work worn institutions of our thrice holy motherland. Thrice holy motherland. This is a holy motherland. This is a holy land. The sacred land. Have no word of condemnation even for the most superstitious and the most irrational office institutions, for, mind you, this line is very important. I'll repeat. Have no word of condemnation even for the most superstitious and the most irrational of its institutions, because, why? Because they also must have served some good in the past. The so-called irrational, superstitious practices must have at certain point of time, at certain era of time, and in a given time and climb, must have served some purpose. So there is no point in condemning them. You can reform them, given the time and climb and the demand of the time, but no condemnation, no abuse. Remember always that there is not in the world any other country whose institutions are really better in their aims and objects than the institutions of this land, the institutions of the Hindus. I have seen castes in almost every country in the world, but nowhere is their plan and their purpose so glorious as here. The rationale, the philosophy, the purpose behind the caste system in this country was so glorious. It was a specialization of the work depending on the aptitude of the persons. Every day and everywhere in the world now you have aptitude tests. Why are you doing aptitude tests for the children, whether they have talent for music or for mathematics or for robotics or computer or software or singers or arts? Because every human being has a particular aptitude, and according to that specialization, to excel in their own field, their field of pursuit, the caste system evolved but degenerated in due process and due course of time due to vested interests. But this objective was noble and grandeur, and it yielded very noble results. We reached to the pinnacle of the human glory through that system alone. I have seen castes in almost every country in the world, but nowhere is their plan and purpose so glorious as here. If caste is thus unavoidable, I would rather have a caste of purity and culture and self-sacrifice than a caste of dollars. Than a caste of dollars. What Swamiji is referring to, in the Western country there is only one caste, and that is the caste of the dollars. Means pursuit of sensual pleasure and pursuit of money and wealth. What are you chasing the money for? What are you chasing your dollars for? For sensual pleasure. Trash sensual pleasure alone is your objective, and each one of you belong to this one caste, the caste of dollars. So let me, I would prefer to belong to that caste of the spiritual seekers, the Brahmins, rather than to belong to the caste of the dollars, is a very profound statement Swamiji is making here. Therefore, utter no words of condemnation, close your lips and let your hearts open. Work out the salvation of this land and of the whole world. Each of you thinking that the entire burden is on your shoulders. Carry the light and the life of the Vedanta. Carry the light and life of the Vedanta to every door and rouse up the divinity that is hidden within every soul. Then, whatever may be the measure of your success, you will have the satisfaction that you have lived, worked, and died for a great cause. In the success of this cause, however, brought about, is centered the salvation of humanity here and hereafter. These Vedantic noble ideals are not for the welfare and salvation of a particular class or caste, but for the entire humanity, entire planet. The lifestyle and livelihood systems woven around, centered around the fundamental principles of Vedanta are bound to become divine, noble, peaceful, because we live in the spirit of yajna. We begin to live in the spirit of, in the light of love, compassion, sympathy, no warfare, no strife. Spread so much of love, spread so much of compassion that there is no chance of the kind of destruction and mayhem you are seeing, the social, ecological, cultural mayhems. So Vedanta is a philosophy not for any particular caste or class. That is why Vedanta alone can become the universal religion. If at all, at any point of time, the humanity comes to this realization that we need some rational principles upon which we can experiment for ourselves, and on the basis of empirical truths, the entire global community must come together and come out with a new religion, and that is the religion, the oldest religion. The new religion would be the oldest, founded on the basis of the oldest religion. Let's hope and pray that the fundamental principles of truth, love, compassion enshrined in Vedanta, the principles of innate divinity of the soul in every human being, irrespective of caste, time, clime, gender, each one of you is nothing but Shiva, the supreme divine force. Realization and manifestation of that divinity is the ultimate objective of Vedanta. The day entire humanity embarks on this radical journey, then and there will be the real revolution on this planet. All the social, political, cultural revolutions on the world, particularly in last 200 to 300 years, have come and gone, proved a little bit of useful in certain respects, but more we change, more we remain the same, in the same predicament of living in fear, living in sorrow, suffering, jealousy, hatred. Break free from all the chains of hatred, jealousy, strife, restlessness, exploitative economic systems, consumerist paradigms, and live in the glory of the divine self, based on the eternal principles of Vedanta. Let that be truths realized, that truth become a reality that throbs in every heart and soul of the world. Sarve nah sukhino bhavantu, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kaschid dukkha bhag bhavet. Om asado ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityurmayamritam gamaya. Om shanti shanti shanti.